I say suburbs.
So, Mission Tristan here today at McCune's in the suburbs of Minneapolis. I'm going to go ahead and introduce a little bit about Jim, about yourself and background.
I'm Chris McCune. I've been training martial arts since I was about 14 years old. I can tell you a lot now, I'm just doing math and figure it out. Been doing Kung Fu for the last 35 years. Been doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for the last 29 years. Third degree black belt in Machado. I've been in the gym in Las Vegas for 10, 11 years. And then came up here. I've been here in Minnesota for the last 17 years. This gym specifically 14 years in this location. And the main things we're training Kung Fu self defense, Brazilian Jiu Jitsu, Muay Thai, MMA. But it was just a title that stuck with me and not many other people. He actually used the title, so the title became a nickname. Of one that is both respect, right? And it just fit the bill for what it was about as well. So that's kind of how I've been addressed for years and years.
Gotcha. Awesome. So let's talk a little bit about class styles now. Are you still actively coaching most of the classes? How many other coaches are involved?
You know, that's an interesting thing because starting a gym on two different occasions. I started one in Las Vegas when I was fairly young, right? And then starting one again here, starting from ground zero with no contacts, and that's a lot of work because you gotta build your base, and you gotta build these relationships.
Right.
I've been fortunate to be blessed with an enthusiasm for the new stuff. Show somebody something that's new or cool, and I see the look on their face and it lights up, and they think it's cool. I'm like, right? And I get super excited about that, so that keeps me going. So if I have the same, 10 guys in that population, never changed. And I've had some of my contemporaries say, hey, would it be cool just to have 10 kill stone cold killers, right? I've had the same 10 guys for 20 years. I would be missing out on that because they get pretty good. It's like it's good stuff, but there's they're going to lose their enthusiasm.
Right.
It's sort of your teaching style. So always want to get a fresh blood in. It's like, hey, I'll always tell you guys, you remember you were like, oh, too. So they're not here to be abused on, right? We're here to get them better. Of course, you're going to have to go through their paces and things, right? Mm-hmm. Just the learning process. But it was the building of that, new people coming in, just flow all the time. And then what happens? Years and years ago, I get that guy's a really good decade, right? And they clearly have great skills. Now, one of the things that I've always taught is you don't have to teach, like, you don't have to be like the movements are going to be different, like, you have preferences, body style. So I've always been very fearful. So my guys have to way up to coach level. When they coach a class, but I'm not counting them. Specific to say you have to do it like A, B, C. How do you do that? And the reason I do that is because I like said something 10 times in a row, and one student doesn't pick it up, right? Well, another coach will say it once, right? That student has this huge attention to me, like, he's never heard this before. Great revelation, right?
You're just sitting over there shaking your
head. Exactly. I've been here doing this for, I've told you that for the last 5 years. And he says it once. So I think it's kind of a joke amongst that, the coaches when that happens, but it's still a good positive thing. So I think when I was younger, I used to make people mad, right? But nowadays it's a cool thing because the ultimate goal is all these guys to get better, right? And to do the training and develop this passion for what I have for pass that on, that's a fantastic thing. And if it's not through me directly, it's through my coaches, and I'm working on that, I will have a lot of coaches that are
involved. Yeah, that's awesome to hear. So, in that kind of theme, do a lot of the guys here compete? Is that like most people's goal, or is that just kind of the side effect?
That's interesting. No, it's kind of, we've got a pretty even mixed bag of. You know, we've got some of our program A-finders that didn't want to get into it. And it also kind of depends on different programs, too. The MMA program kind of leads more to eventually we're going to do some type of competition, of some sort, but not necessarily like the guys in there that have no desire to do it and for conditional training, right? And that's okay. The jiu-jitsu guys also have a little bit more of a competitive side to them. We do encourage them tournaments as often as we can. But I don't force it into it, right? But really, you know, we've got small pockets of guys that are hardcore competitors. And they'll train hard, you know, to do that. But the vast majority of people come in are either in full or getting in shape, self-defense, or to have fun and you know, learn something cool while they're having fun with this group of like-minded people, right? So those are all major areas. And I kind of cater to all of them. If we get the big bruisers going in the MMA, the big bruisers can beat up the big bruisers, right? You know, I'm not sending in the mean, tough guy, the brand new, you know, quiet guy. You know, that's not cool. You've never seen anybody do that. So we try to match everybody up with good role partners. Now, that being said, we have such a good group. Muay Thai guys are specialists. MMA guys, broader, right? Okay. But how many multiple points are you fighting?
Just the one.
Exactly, right? Right? And there usually is a referee there. Although you can find some pickup fights underneath the bridges that are more risky. So the rules are there, so they don't name each other. And if you know, tap out, or it's not a dishonor to do that, then you're okay with that. But, well, I'll always ask them if they're more interested in doing something else. So next time you get a tournament, how's it going? They don't really want to answer that question, right? I don't know how to ask the question either. Are you in your car in like the situation that you just happened to be all these downtown areas where you're in a car and then you got all these, you know, angry protesters and officers, and you know, and then somebody goes, and then starts dragging you out of the car. Is that what it is? Is it, I go sour with you right now, if I can hit. Okay. Is it, two guys can match in a parking lot and get nice? Right? Is it that they're trying to drag their girlfriend off another, off of the, I don't know, how does it happen? Is it two guys, one guy, multiple tacklers? I don't know. Are you sitting down, you're standing up? Is it a wet circle, is it a pool? Right? So you don't know exactly the scenario that happens. The jiu-jitsu guys, specific snap. The MMA guys train for a specific snap, right? And it has certain controls in it. Okay? In the real world, it's don't necessarily have those controls in its way. Exactly, right? Right? So one, it gives you a broader retinue of things that you do, right? Right? Okay, so a Muay Thai roundhouse kick. Well, it's super fucking powerful. It should be part of your cultural arsenal, right? That's a great kick to have, and when you use it versus a different kick, right? Or being able to do a rear design. Okay, that's just real world application stuff that works. So yes, of course you should have that as part of the retina. And a couple guys are really creative on how they set it up. okay? So the Kung Fu for me, this particular style of Kung Fu, it has such a great foundation of flexibility of practicality, right? So it's not a fully integrated style, but it's a hands-on style. So we very much pay close attention to all the stuff that works in other arts, too, and that just becomes part of the Kung Fu itself.
That's awesome. When I hear all this flexibility and the incorporation that you use, you're really hyping up Kung Fu now, and I'm like, sad.
Right.
No,
I'm
like,
sorry.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah. You know, coming in, I didn't really know quite what to expect. I was like, you know, you're coming through, you do a general stereotype.
Oh, totally.
What a dojo would look like.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll add to that, that I don't have the best directly as Kung Fu, because once again, I come into this perception, this notion that it is a traditional style. I have nothing against what traditional style is, but that's not my game. Right? And if you come in expecting a fully traditional style and you see this, it's not going to be what you want.
It's a rough awakening.
Oh, yeah. It's not, did he just bite that guy? You know? Yeah, that is part of the game. You're right. But you're like that. That's not what I expected. Right. So I don't have this. Is it? Yeah, it's a guy's on here. It's sort of quiet. Right. But it's really, really sweet sometimes. Right. And that's not to say that. Like I said, it's just like, here's this traditional art that we say, oh, it's the baddest way on the planet. So we're like, no, we very much pay attention. A dear friend of mine, also a Sanskrit master, Kathy Long, which is my time for Chapter King Master. She and I are related to the master gender, our instructor, an individual. So very much pay attention to the kickboxers, the boxers, right? Because I don't know in the street, I'm going to run into a boxer, a jiu-jitsu guy, or a wrestler, right. Or a... So, Kung Fu guys, as I was called, jack-of-all-trades. Part of the Kung Fu guys test is, if you're going for a Kung Fu black belt, just a little bit certainly, if you're going for a Kung Fu black belt, you still have to play the jiu-jitsu game as part of your test with the purple belt, with the level or higher. And do I expect you to win against the specialist? And I bound you to is to win the jiu-jitsu. Say, I don't expect you to win against the specialist, but I expect you to beat the specialist in a really difficult time. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's part of their black belt test, because they're not specialists in jiu-jitsu at that point. Now, conversely speaking, jiu-jitsu is talking to many pieces of movement. It's good jiu-jitsu. I mean, you might have some lessons in jiu-jitsu pieces. Yeah. But Machado's law has been very well prepared about as well. There's a lot of opposite sample. Grappling parts, but for the most part, it's grappling. I don't test the jiu-jitsu guys with expectations to know how to do, you know, roundhouse kicks to the head. You're right, right? But because of those guys have experience and jack of all trades, yeah, they have to be able to do many experiments, right? Do I expect you as going to be a specialist pro? No, but I do expect you to be able to give him a hard time at his own game, right? And then that being said, your retinue is so much broader than that. Okay, so if you get a rule with, like, you know, for a fact that the guy is, let me tell you, you know for a fact, you just know how they move him.
You see the legs
ready to
go.
Are you going to go back and shins with him?
So,
hell no. Why would you do that? That's dumb tactics there, right? So, and I'm not saying that you're all you got to do is take him down. But if you had to fight, you would not fight him. No, you pull up some different tricks, things that are outside their box that we're good at, right? And so if you're a JJ specialist, yeah, obviously you take it goes
right,
there, right?
Yeah.
And conversely speaking, if you were a Muay Thai guy and you knew he was a BJ specialist, are you just going to roll and tackle him? Oh, hell no. Right. So, but that being said, you can't just go in. Oh, I can remember the early UFCs were this way, right? You get the Muay Thai guy or the boxer that thinks he's just going to win, but he'll never take me down. I heard that from the Muay Thai guys way back in the day, right? I'm like, have you ever worked that? So, of course, they have a war that, right? And that's, of course, what they're looking for. They're looking for a guy who's so comfortable with his stuff, that he's not working with anything, and they end up going to win, because they're immediately pulled out of their element. And then pulled up. You're right, and then so... especially with the but I want you to experience all of that. I want you to come and work with the jiu-jitsu guys. can be familiar with it, right? I'm used to having all the same tools that will really ruin your day, right? Because you know what everything's supposed to do, right? Because you have the experience of it, right? And obviously, the relationship both in MMA and Muay Thai education is absolutely destructive, right? Yeah. Anything that works for that degree, I'll just get some culture.
Awesome. It sounds like you've got a really comprehensive program, well thought out, and just super involved in a lot of different aspects. So, wrapping up here, we just had a little bit about the situation, but where can we find
but you still want to try to introduce me to one call out in a heartbeat after the 40 orders. Yeah, well, you know, exactly, and those perfect. You know, it's always rough losing somebody. You know, so if I lose somebody from either just from COVID in general, right, or losing from, okay, well, I would like to see everybody in hazmat suits while they're grappling, which if you really want to do that, and so that's what you have to do, doing what we do, because it's just kind of, you know, and I hate being losing. But I've lost people on very successful like this. He had some tricky things bumping in his hand. He wouldn't be rough on him or anything, but he was just getting him off. You know, and it sucks. He's such a good guy, right? But he's going to lose his job because he's out from his knees. So that's the assessment. You know, I can't keep doing this because if I do more time, I lose my job. That's he hates the hands, but I mean, that's his risk assessment, right? I mean, I totally respect that. Even though it sucks, you know, I am losing these guys. Really that's kind of how it happens. So yeah, the fact is, oh yeah, great, you know, it was a big hit to income, all from training, and we literally had 3 months of just doing occasional private lessons, and then we started opening up the kickboxing class, and then we started opening up a class or two. And I'll be honest with you, the first kind of jiu-jitsu class, it was on a Monday, it was just like a test run.
Right?
Yeah, a little tester. And then we had a lot of people. Like, a lot of people. And then consistently, a lot of people. And they went to the second one, to like spread out a little, you know, right? We had a lot of people twice. So it was. Tonight was actually kind of a very quiet night, so it was very interesting. So that's not just me. That's not me calling. They don't know what it is. They don't assess my company, but they literally just train. That's what they are. And training, stay healthy. Just don't worry the stress of this. I put on a couple of COVID pounds, and I'm like, I'm not happy about that either. So.
Yeah. Yeah, but some of the others didn't talk about it. Too.
Yeah.
So if we're going to have pizza.
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah, the pizza place has a fast food joint, so they did okay.
Anywhere that can deliver.
Yeah, exactly.
Cool. So kind of turning towards the end here, but I've got some aspects here about your relationship with other gyms in the area, relationship with the guys coming into the gym and how everything's running. But do you have any specific sort of gym operating philosophies or stylistics that you try to really like?
Oh, yeah. A number one. it's not so loose, it's just cans. Right? Again, like what I told you, the coaches, themselves. Right? Like what's their style? Show that to the guys. Because I might not have that style. I've got 130 pounders in here, and I have 200 pounds. That's a big difference in style.
It's huge.
Right? So, I want everybody to pick up on that smaller styles too. And then that makes sense. A couple 300 pounders, right? They're players, right? That's a big guy's game. So, from them, they're pretty insightful as well. You can see stuff from that too. But come in. I want everybody to have fun. Move on to the level of your capability and desire, right? So, we'll push hard if you want to push hard. If you're all chill and you want to just really fun, that's fine too. Whatever each person is. In doing that, I've been a lot of gyms going on. The BJJ guys were rivals of the Muay Thai guys.
Yeah,
right? In the same gym, right? And that's strange to me. We don't have that. We have all the Christmas parties, right? Right? And we all support the other, like, there's a big jiu-jitsu tournament that Muay Thai's a Christmas tournament. Or like Sean or any of our other fighters, Derek Kessler, or these, if they're up to a fight, right? There's no gym supporting them. They're online or they're playing. They actually do real fights next week here. Right? Hopefully they'll be coming back sometime soon. And then the Kung Fu guys, and everybody just shakes their head at the Kung Fu guys. I mean, that just combat. Well, because it's like, it's a combative Kung Fu, so it's like,
okay.
It's like
okay.
Whatever rule is in the university, it's a rule.
Can't grab hair,
can't gouge an eye, can't bite, can't tear in here, right? Can't grab bone, can't hit spine, right? Can't headbutt, right? You can't do an acronym, I don't quite understand, 12-6 elbow, you can't do a 12-6 elbow. I'm sorry, I'm full of it on myself, I'm not a 12-6 elbow.
Yeah, I've read some interesting things about the whole thing.
Right. You can't do that, you need to do a finger. So these types of rules provide an okay? Because it's a way to show you skills like this, right? It's better. You should have those skills even in Kung Fu and things, right? But it's just a function of the shift to fail, right? And you have to survive. I'm going to peel the finger, I'm peeling the finger. I'm just fine. I can, bury my thumb like an eyesight. I would bury the thumb like an eyesight. But for survival, it's not for competition reasons, so who's got the best skills reasons. There's nice that. So it's different application too. And I also say this too, but it's like guys who are here that are out there. There really are like bad attitudes here. That's gonna have bad angles in a while. But everybody gets along, we have this shared passion, and everybody's here respecting everybody else. So it almost doesn't matter what part they get, even if you're either hugely outsized or hugely outclassed. They'll still play to whatever that language is, and we're all respecting each other.
It was a really nice environment coming in here. Like we talked about, tonight's part of the mishmash kind of thing on, but it was a good environment. We guys were pretty friendly. It was like, pretty kind of cooperative spirit. Like, I just got some people rolling over here, some people just doing lights of arm, and like everyone just kind of jumped around, a lot of chat, too.
Yeah,
it's a friendly place.
Oh, yeah. I have a strong feeling. That's kind of cool. Other gyms teach you different patterns, which are general patterns. There's gym in town that moves, there's like IBJJF specific key all the time. That is how they train by that set of rules all the time. Now, if that's what you want, as a client, you come into me, I would have to tell you, this is, that's really not ours. That's really not how we focus. Ours can do a lot of like, we do a lot of like, we do yes, which is something that IBJJF rules, but we serve you a lot of things that are not on IBJJF. And frankly, the vast majority of our guys prefer the rules. The IBJJF rules typically cumbersome on one hand, but also never too restrictive.
Okay.
Right? And that's just not feeling hard. But I would definitely refer you, if you were strictly looking for IBJJF competition, I would refer you to a big gym because that's what they're focusing on. If you come to me and sign up and that's what you want, then you're like, the company doesn't want to have it. Right? So that is not what you want. So be so very honest about it. What you come in and what you expect is, you know, that's kind of important. If you're not getting what you expect, but how does it hold itself? I mean, how do you have it?
As a, just as a general member of plenty of gyms, both martial arts based and not, I appreciate that. Because, like, you don't want to have the time wasted. And you know, there's only so much to it where it's like, yes, you got me, I'm paying money, but then if I'm unhappy at a gym, like, it just goes poorly for everyone. So, yeah, definitely agree with that.
Yeah, and we're a mature enough gym now that we used to do one-year contracts. Right? Mm-hmm. When we're a younger gym, you kind of need that to make sure everybody's committed to. Now, I'm committed to you for that same year that you're committed to me, right? Kind of thing. But I was never such a hard ass to don't tell me this because it's all been on it. That, I mean, if you have good reason to, hey, we're not happy with you, you want a job in a contract, right? Or if you need a job change, stuff like that. And some of the other gyms were much more strict than other companies. We're mature enough now that I don't have a two-day part of the company. I do like ongoing, out of pay, month to month. Really is canceled at any time, right? So it's just to talk about the bodies, right? And what that has allowed us to do is, even if guys do have to take a break, there's not a lot of pressure to just be able to do a couple of three years now, this is super standard. But I've been told it's going to be a little bit of a break now. Yeah, we understand life charges and all that sort of stuff. So we come back. So even if we don't come back, we get the great referrals because of that we treat them so well, right? And I pick up a lot of people that were pretty hard on the lead on their contracts and very unhappy. And bothers the hell out of me because then I'm doing damage control, not for the other guys, right? But for this particular relationship, for this particular person who, man, they started to look at this stuff and it's so cool, and then that spoiled it for us. I'm glad you're here trying to do that because not all places are the same.
Right. Definitely good to see. Yeah, and like I understand too that you are a younger gym or something, or even if it's just an experience, whatever it is, like sometimes it's hard to get that kind of leeway, but like once you do, like once you can afford to, like yeah, it's great, and it's like, you know, it's a lot of good things. So I'm glad that you did that with you guys too, and yeah, that's cool. Alright, so I'm gonna left turn here.
Okay.
And hear what happened during or post corona. How it's changed, how numbers might have fluctuated. You tell me about how you are flexible, Jim, and that's a time where you got to be flexible. You know, rigid breaks. So.
Yeah, that was kind of a tough time. I mean, interesting enough, I was heading out to a trip with my boy. We just turned 21, so we're going to go to a father-son trip. Originally, it was going to be Las Vegas. The flight didn't work out right on that one. It was like right at St. Patty's Day, March 17th, was when this day got shut down. So we on the day that the shit got shut down. And I was so pissy about it. I was one of the last gyms to actually shut down. And I've got a couple of my friends over the gyms in the area as well. And I was going to give me a little credit to the safety. And I told them, I'm saying, that's not going to take you, which I appreciate. But I'm like, let me see the real numbers. We talked about that earlier. Let me see the real numbers on this. And I'll shut down anyway. So it was 3 months of people on board for 3 months because if nobody's traveling, nobody's paying dues, nobody's in, how do I pay my money at all? Yeah, it's kind of my support, it's my life's passion. So yeah, no, that was a little scary. Now, that being said, developing the relationships that we had were probably. You know, some of the people during COVID, I mean, they lose their jobs, and of course they have to do stuff on board, and they can't come to totally understand. But there was a couple of incentive programs, like the exchange, like learning lessons for the professors. You stay on, you know, stay on, you know, place holding, you know, me or one of the coaches, we give you an honest part of the work for each month. So there were a couple of incentive programs that they had were working pretty well. And everybody kind of stayed on board, like, you know, 60-75% it's time. Then then a couple of the programs we had. I had more heavy bags in here on the rail at the time.
So, okay.
So I did like a cardio, a limited number of cardio boxing camp where we could maintain some social distancing. We're pretty open at this gym. McCune's MA.com, right, is our main website on that. We have a Facebook page on the same, McCune's Martial Arts. And again, social media has kind of shrunk a little bit just because the atmosphere is so volatile outside. So we've all been kind of quiet, just doing our thing. Shout out, certainly my coaches.